Senator Pam Iovino, it is a pleasure to be sitting back with you again. I know it's been a while. I don't know, 6-8 months, maybe a little longer since we sat down and chatted. And a lot has changed this year with the pandemic coming to our country and also the economic crises and so forth. But what I'd like to do before we get into, I have some specific talking points I'd like to ask you about. You know, tell me for yourself and your family and so forth, how are you handling being stuck at home for 6 months like the rest of us? You, I'm sure both professionally and personally, things have affected you too, haven't they?
They certainly have, and it's very nice to be back with you again, Andy. Thank you for the invitation. And we couldn't have imagined how much has changed when we were last together. For me personally, it has, the most impact has been on my work. Like many of us, I work from home now. I don't travel to Harrisburg. I don't go into district offices. I happen to live alone, by myself, so it's, we still gather family-wise, but it's been all outdoors. So until we hit better weather, I didn't, weeks and was stretched out before I saw, between times that I got to see family. But I think like everybody else, there is not an option but to adapt.
Yeah.
And so that's that's what
you
I find myself doing, and helping others who need help doing that same adapting.
So you're all your office and everything you're just doing from home and via virtual meetings and, you know, with your staff and everything?
Yeah, we knew that we were going to have to close the offices, and we had about a 48-hour window, and I taught the staff a term I learned in the Navy. It was the go bag that was always packed. Oh, you were always ready to go, and so they did that basically for their work supplies and materials they would need from home, so that we could still continue to provide for our constituents.
Okay, with your offices being closed, and I know it's a little harder to work with your constituents and so forth, but, you know, tell me what you are doing for your constituents. How are you communicating? What is your office able to provide still? Are you open for business? You're wide open, other than they just can't come into your office itself. What are you doing for everybody?
So we are able to have virtually business as usual.
Okay.
The hours that we're open are the same. And we do things by phone and email, and sometimes by virtual and Zoom meetings like that. There's a couple things that you need to do in person, that like a notary service or something like that. We do accommodate that. It's by appointment. But the whole list of services, whether people need help with their getting relief for, you know, rent rebate or duplicate applications for something, birth certificates, death certificates. I mean, everything that we did as constituent services before, we are continuing to do. Obviously, we have seen a great ramp up in people's needs that are related to COVID.
Okay.
So we've had over 850 constituent service cases that have to do with unemployment. We do a lot now that has to do with mail-in voting, that people were starting to think about November, and people want to be able, they want to know what their options are and how to do that. So I'm extremely proud of the staff. We still get, you know, good reports on how we're doing in terms of taking care of the folks out there. But we just made that accommodation to do it from home, so everybody's in their individual homes.
Do you have the same staff? Did you have to increase, decrease staff? Or?
The staff has been the same.
Okay.
Yeah. There, for a very brief time, there was actually a hiring freeze at the state level. But we weren't, but that did not impact us either way. No, they've just been working very hard. The state at the employer has included like compassionate care training for staff, because it's really, It's demanding and stressful what they're having to do on a day in and day out basis.
So I you know, the unemployment and the calls that you're taking because of COVID-19, has it had a emotional turmoil with your staff, or everyone in your office is handling everything and going through fine.
We keep good tabs on each other because it is hard to have an 8, 10, or 12-hour day because sometimes they don't stop just because 5 o'clock hits. They are hearing from people who are in stress or distress, and the staff are very compassionate people. And so it's not just a job to them.
Right.
And so it does. But what they're doing is they're holding each other up. They're also everything keeps evolving too. You know, where's another resource? Where can we turn? You know, help this tell this person to turn to. So we're getting better and better at it. We've seen a little bit of a drop off from the unemployment calls.
Okay.
But that could go in waves just as easily.
So is there still the normal ways that constituents are getting a hold of your office from phone, emails, everything? There's nothing changed on that end of it?
Nothing changed on that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. The next that I hot topic today here in Bethel Park, today's the first day the teachers go back to work. Mm-hmm. And students are supposed to be going back September 1st, and all our bordering communities with Peters and South Park, Mount Lebanon, all of them. It's a pretty important topic right now, even above and beyond everything else that the pandemic is doing for us. But, you know, on the state level, how are you handling or working to help school districts with, you know, the limited resources they have and the budgets and guidance and everything else? Can you talk to us a little bit about what you're doing in the way of education in your...
Absolutely. So it's a hot topic. It's an emotional topic. It's a critical topic in terms of the education of our youth. We immediately turn to ensuring that getting the CARES money out and distributed to various sectors, education was high on that list.
Okay.
So some of the monies that have been distributed already were $215 million for our K-12 school districts, and whether that was for PPE or COVID-related expenses that were not planned in their budget, technology needs, sanitizing needs, things like that. $125 million of CARES money was distributed. We got out for early child care and early education. And then there was a $72 million. This had to do with higher education and some student loan debt relief, things like that. But I have personally met multiple times in roundtables with my superintendent, so I could hear from them and hear exactly what were, you know, the problems that they were dealing with. I have been so impressed with them every time I've met with them because they're concerned about their student, the family, the faculty, the staff that works with them. They're concerned about not just this child's education, but there is not one of these times or one of these superintendents that doesn't bring up the mental health of the child or of the faculty, the impact that this is having in that way too. They are really dedicated, incredible professionals. The other thing we did with regard to the budget is we appropriated the whole 12 months of budget for school districts. Every other aspect of the budget only got 5 months worth of funding. But school districts, you know, they couldn't operate without some assurance. Without knowing. Mm-hmm. It's a school year that they have to plan for. So we did that. And it's ongoing. I mean, there's more CARES monies that Pennsylvania has already received to be distributed. And then in addition to that, the federal government, I just hope, continues to act again and we see some action on the HEROES Act.
So you're talking to either superintendent or people from the school district almost daily right now then?
Well, they have access to me daily, but I have organized a couple roundtables. Some have been with the superintendents, also with the school board members.
Okay. I was going to ask you whether you're talking to the school board members too, because they seem to have not different agendas or the same agenda, but different point of view than sometimes the superintendents do on it. And, you know, they're just as passionate as the superintendents are for it.
They come at it from a different aspect.
Right.
Same objective, same constituency, our kids that they care, that they're working for. But, and I was meeting with these people before COVID. I mean, there's a close relationship between the Harrisburg and state government and public education. But now we've been doing it via Zoom.
Yeah. Well, changing gears a little bit, probably on the topics that I was thinking that's most important to me personally, the business side of it, as mm-hmm. being a small business owner in Pennsylvania. I'm very passionate about the business community itself. And just a few little numbers that I picked up looking this morning, there's 28.8 million small businesses in the United States. 99.7% of all businesses in the United States are small businesses. And last year, 64% of the growth of employment in the United States was through small businesses. And the pandemic has been brutal, absolutely brutal, to the small businesses of all sort. I mean, yes, everyone's aware of the restaurants and bars, but even the smaller mom-and-pop stores, whether it's, you know, 3 employees or 30 employees, it has to be something that you're as concerned with as I am.
And add one more statistic to what you said, and that is that small businesses are the single largest job creators in the country. Yep. So imagine what sort of impact that has through ripples throughout the whole economy if with all of those statistics that you just rattled off. So what we did was we something called the Main Street Grant Program was established. It has been a blueprint for other states. Pennsylvania was the first to do it. And we carved out CARES money that allowed for these grants for small businesses. And they weren't overly encumbered of what, the PPP was great for mm-hmm. what it did.
Yep.
But there were some encumbrances about it. The small businesses, other than having criteria of how many employees, it was 25 or less full-time equivalent.
Full-time employees, right.
Mm-hmm. And annual gross of $1 million would define a small business, and got these grants out to them. So the first wave of them is going to, the first wave has of 96 million of the 225 million that was carved out for it has been distributed. It will impact in Allegheny County and Washington County, 500 small businesses are going to benefit from it. And that was just the first wave. There are still more of the 225 million to be distributed. So,
and so, you know, with that, is there in the future, first wave you're saying, so I'm assuming there's a second wave that you're working on, or is any of it going to be earmarked just for restaurants and, you know, bars and so forth that seem to be being affected more than any of the other mm-hmm. types of businesses there are?
Absolutely. So there is absolutely a second wave because those monies have been set aside and appropriated. That's the remainder of the $225 million. My caucus, we got together specifically to address some of the impact on the restaurant and tavern business. And we'd like to see carved out another $100 million go exclusively for that business sector. And they're adamant, you know, they...
Yes, they are.
They don't want handouts.
No.
They want to reopen.
Correct.
But there's a voice within them that also, you know, speaks to, they know it has to be done safely. Mm-hmm. They know they don't want the business liability. They don't want the exposure for themselves. That's also part of this package. And so they have to weather this storm. So they may not want it to be look like a handout.
Right.
I don't believe it does not appear that way to me. This is really just a bridge
When it's time to reopen, they want to be there to be able to reopen.
They want to still be alive. To open the front door.
Right.
Exactly.
Yeah. Have you spent a lot of time talking to them? Have you heard from many of the business owners?
We do, particularly during the time when the waiver process was going on,
right,
of what was essential and non-essential.
Right.
That was a large part of our call time. Now that's sort of sorted itself out. Everybody is permitted to be open. It's just under what conditions and limitations they're allowed to be open.
Are you still in conversations with them?
I introduced legislation for business owners to have clear the any ambiguous language about whether they are eligible to file claims under their business interruption aspects of their policies.
Sure.
These are business owners. They've been paying their premiums all these years, and now they
have some of them 40, 50 years and no claims.
And no claims because of, and this would not, if they had exclusively had a no virus part of it, this wouldn't make them eligible to have a claim.
Okay.
But barring that, this is a business interruption through no fault of their own, through what has been a declared disaster. And
right.
that's really key to it, that some entity, you know, outside of them declared this a disaster. So I'm going to be pushing hard come September, even later this week, we're going to do a press conference on the business interruption insurance.
Have you had any big pushback from the insurance companies?
The strongest pushback that they've pushed back is to the leadership in the Senate to not schedule hearings or committee votes to get the legislation out of committee and then to get it to the floor. So it's being blocked.
Okay. You'll win.
It's the side of right. It's
yes.
the side of helping
yeah.
our business owners in these unprecedented times. So I hope I do win because really they win.
Good.
And it's the right thing to do.
As a business owner, I hope you win too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we need that to win. Well, in our community itself, one of my other passions is our public library. Mm-hmm. So switching from the business side of it to more of a personal side of it, there's a lot of other aspects in a community that are struggling, and one of them would be our public libraries. They're critical to our community. I consider the Bethel Park Public Library to be the center of Bethel Park, and everything revolves around it. Is there hope to help the libraries in Allegheny County and neighboring communities to weather this pandemic?
It's a great question, and they are that. I agree with you, sort of a heart of a community oftentimes, maybe even more so during times like this, because people need alternative activities to do when we've become limited. Our students need it, our seniors need it. People who are unemployed need access to those computers in there. And the library's ability to pivot and be creative and during this has been really impressive and fun to watch in some cases. This is another case where it's the impact of the loss of revenues that is what
yes,
it boils down to.
That's the critical part of it.
That's the critical part of it. And we will not see an increase of revenues. We are seeing a significant decrease.
Right.
We're still waiting to see what that final number looks like, what that hit is going to look like for us. And so we need the federal government to come in and help us. We
mm-hmm.
need the next CARES package to be have some specific monies for state, but even more so local governments, municipal governments.
Well, I'll be counting on you to fight our battles for us,
as
you always do.
We have, as a delegation, written to the Pennsylvania delegation, congressional delegation,
mm-hmm.
Imploring them to please pass this HEROES Act.
Well, how about moving within the community now? How about our emergency service, our fire, our police, our EMS, and so forth. They're having the same problems as the library. I mean, there's so much money that is needed for cleaning and keeping them safe and their PPE and everything else on it. What is the state doing to help out our first responders?
So again, a large portion of the CARES money that we got, the over $4 billion that Pennsylvania got, was specifically earmarked for the first responders that are the law enforcement, the EMS, the fire departments, and police, to do that, to make sure that they had all of the PPE and things that they needed. We increased a grant program by $50 million specifically for EMS and volunteer fire departments because the hit that they are taking so much of their
no fundraisers.
There's no fundraisers
yeah.
that they can do. We also introduced legislation that would they would have the ability to do more online kind of gaming things that, they often do raffle type things. So this would give them the ability to do it online. I think we're going to see a certain amount of more and more pressure because of the loss of funds that some of these volunteer fire departments, EMS, they're going to have to think about consolidating.
Right. Okay.
It's always been an issue. The pandemic has sort of
forcing
the hand of into some realities about it. There was a hearing on it yesterday. One of the committees that I chair, well, the committee I chair, one of the committees I'm on, but I happen to chair, Veterans Affairs and Emergency Preparedness.
Okay.
For the municipalities to actually create authorities, so that then there would be an authority which these consolidated entities would work under. So we'll see what happens in September. First step was the hearing. Mm-hmm. Next is bringing
or
our committee. Or
the EMS and fire departments, and are they all aware of the grant money that's out there for them?
I'll tell you what. We have our demographics. When we need to get word out about whether it's funding for a child care center or funding for a fire department, mm-hmm. As soon as that grant money or the date of that application is going to be announced when it's going to open, we're blasting them out.
Okay.
So that money was turned around very quickly because okay. it was gone. And it's the other reason it was gone so quickly is. It's just never enough.
No.
It's just never enough.
No.
Mm-hmm. This isn't so much about it includes first responders, but recently we appropriated $50 million in hazard pay for certain categories of first responders.
Okay.
It was $50 million. It's not an insignificant amount of money. 10,000 applications amounting to $900 million in need. Some of those may not have qualified, but the bulk of them probably were legitimate.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So.
It's a tough pick. Who gets it? Who doesn't?
It is a tough pick. Yeah. And mm-hmm.
Well, how about with the other aspect of our communities, and that's the seniors, the senior citizens, the nursing homes. I mean, every community from that you're involved in has nursing homes to it, and some of them fared better than others. There's some that didn't fare too well at all. The senior community has to be on your mind also, along with everything else that you are dealing with on a daily basis. Can you speak, towards the seniors, the nursing homes, the senior living centers, and so forth?
We know that, if one is in a certain age demographic or a certain health compromised situation or has pre-existing conditions or underlying compromised immune systems, that they're more vulnerable to how severe COVID hits them or whether they survive it. When you add to that congregate care settings like our nursing homes,
right.
It is one of the most vulnerable populations and then places to be. I co-chaired a policy hearing on it early on so that we could hear from the first responders and hear from our Pennsylvania Health Department and our Human Services Department about what they were doing. What was happening with regard to getting adequate and enough testing out for residents, for staff, that policy hearing was not just nursing homes, but I included in it because of my interest in this. We have 6 state veteran homes in Pennsylvania.
I was going to ask you that one.
Mm-hmm. And one in particular, it's the Southeast Veteran Center.
Okay.
It's been one of the catastrophe situations in terms of not of people contracting it and sadly people dying from it, and it took them too long to get a handle on it, so we included the veterans homes in it too. Mm-hmm. Well, and I'm still concerned about that, the veterans homes.
Well, I mean, it's whether we flatten the curve and we got another one coming up right now. I mean, it has to weigh heavily on you with your day-to-day job with mm-hmm. what you're doing. What else? I mean, I just had a couple things here mm-hmm. that I wanted to ask you, but there has to be other things that are on your mind that you're working with at the state level and also helping us at the county mm-hmm. level and community level? What else is going on?
I guess it would be remiss if I just, you know, we have a new definition of like frontline worker now. Mm-hmm. And that was another large portion of the CARES money that we pushed out, over $750 million, so almost $750 million for healthcare workers.
Right.
These in nursing homes or in our hospitals, for the retail grocery stores, you know, place everywhere that was a critical essential business that could not close, that had interaction with the public, and the place that they, the vulnerability that they were putting themselves in to serve all of us and take
sure.
care of us on a daily basis. So we, so I'm concerned about, you know, I still remain concerned about that. We've seen that, you know, the compliance with mask wearing and social distancing, it flattens the curve. We contain the spread, and we can buy the time we need to get the vaccine to make everybody safe from this virus, from this new novel coronavirus that we just don't know enough about yet. So those, that's it. This consumes me really every
24/7.
24/7.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Well, I really appreciate you taking the time to sit down and chat with us, and also for our viewers to find out directly from you some of the things that are going on with you and with our state, which directly affect us every minute of our lives right now. And, mm-hmm. you know, for me, I just want to thank you for everything you're doing for us. And I do appreciate you taking the time to visit with us today.
Thank you very much for having me, Andy.
Okay.
Thank you.